everybody, and welcome to On the Spectrum. I'm your host, Aneri Patani, and we're here at Cox Studio in Cheshire. For those of you who haven't been with us before, we have a very unique show here. Every member of our production team is on the autism spectrum, and they always do a great job of putting on an entertaining and informative show for all of you at home. Tonight, we'll be continuing our series on financial planning for parents with a child on the spectrum. Today, we'll be discussing Social Security benefits. Our guest is Dave Hampton. Dave was a claims representative for the Social Security Administration for 26 years and is now the owner of Professional Secure Assistance. Thank you for joining us tonight, Dave.
Oh, you're quite welcome. Thanks for inviting me.
Can you tell us a little bit about your experience with Social Security benefits for people with disabilities?
I'd be happy to. I worked for the Social Security Administration from 1981 to 2006. I retired out, took some time for myself. And then in late 2007, early 2008, I started representing people. And what that means is that the agency agreed that I had the credentials to properly represent people when they were pursuing Social Security disability and or any other type of Social Security benefit.
Okay. And why would you say it's important for parents to look into these sorts of benefits for their children with disabilities?
It is a short-term and a long-term consideration. In the short term, if a young person, male or female, has some illness, injury, or condition that keeps them from working 5 days a week, 6 to 8 hours a day, lifting, pushing, pulling, whatever the job may be, then they could be determined to be disabled by Social Security. There are two types of Social Security disability, though. There is Social Security disability, which is for individuals who have worked. The joke about who's FICA and why does he take money out of my check every week. Well, when you pay that FICA tax, you are now a covered employee, and you could be eligible for Social Security disability insurance. Everybody refers to it as SSDI. The other program, SSI, Supplemental Security Income, is a needs-based program. So you hear a lot about, well, I can only have $2,000 in liquid assets. I can own a car, but I can't own two cars. Where I live makes a difference. How much I have in a bank account. That's the SSI program. That's the needs-based. Why is it important? It's important because you are not only trying to fund the individual now, and let's remember, child, I'm always going to be my parents' child. Social Security says that the second that I turn 18 years old, I'm now a legal adult. No more definition child, now I'm legal adult. The difference there is that when you are a child under the age of 18, your parents' income and resources, it's called deeming, just what's theirs is yours, okay? And so, when Social Security does that, because it's a needs-based program, it's a lot like the state programs, you know, the food stamps and the medical card, same thing. And so when they look at parents' income and resources, more times than not, if both parents are working and they have good jobs, good salaries, when they do the deeming and they share a portion of that over to this now adult, the adult is now ineligible. So what you're trying to do is you wait until the child is 18 years old. Then the now adult can file on their own. The parents, the home they have, the 401, their pension, the boat they own, whatever it is, doesn't count towards this individual anymore.
Okay.
Now, once that is established, that the person is disabled, and you can get both, because some young people, they work bagging groceries, working at a local store, a lot of things that you could do, okay? But if they work and they were to get what are called quarters of coverage, $1,040 of wages gives you a quarter coverage, and the younger you are, the less you have to have. An adult, let's say 30, 40 years old, has to have 10 years or 40 quarters. A young person only 21 might only need 6. Okay, so that's something that I would look at for the person. The end game is to get your now adult determined to be disabled by Social Security between the ages of 18 and 22. Why? Because that's, if they are determined to be disabled between the ages of 18 and 22, they are now a disabled adult child. That means that when, let's say you, mm-hmm. when your parents either die, file for retirement, or become disabled themselves, you can then move on to their Social Security benefit as an auxiliary. Okay? Then when they pass away, you would receive their Social Security amount for the rest of your life. So it's a funding issue. Okay. What's going to happen to David when mom and dad are no longer around and they don't have the ability to make sure that I have a good place to live, my bills are being paid, so forth and so on.
One thing you mentioned that surprised me a little, you said someone can apply for both SSDI and SSI at the same time?
Yes.
And is that, would that be a separate application process for each or a joint process? It just, it seems a little contradictory to me. I'm not understanding exactly.
Okay. SSDI, you file an application which is basically your name, your date of birth, your address, where do you live, where were you born, have you ever worked, what are you alleging are your disabling illnesses, injuries, or conditions, autism, deafness, high cholesterol, whatever, okay? That's an application, as Social Security defines it. Then there is the medical report, which then tells Social Security what the doctors and the medical evidence, what they say about in comparison to what you have alleged.
Okay.
So if a person were to allege that they had a heart problem, yet there's no medical records, then the allegation is what it is, but there's no medical evidence to support it.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
Okay.
In your experience, have you found individuals or parents who are hesitant to apply for these benefits, either because they find the process intimidating or they're just, you know, they would like their children to lead normal lives?
I think that it's a little of both. I tell parents all the time, you have to separate out that this is your baby that we're talking about, okay? You need to take the emotion out of it because Social Security doesn't look at emotion. Whatever your hopes and dreams or cares or wants for your child may be, that's terrific. And whatever happens out there someday, Social Security is good with it. But for right now, they're looking at what the individual, based on illnesses, injuries, or conditions, would not be able to do. Now, for some individuals, they have, you hear the term limited functionality. Okay, so there are things that they can do. But then there's other individuals, you know, that they really can't, they don't drive because they can't get a driver's license. They can't use the stove. You know, they've been taught how to do things, but they have to be refreshed. They have to be monitored. And so you have spectrum. You
right.
have this
mm-hmm.
wide range of individuals, high to low, that... you have to look at, and that, I think, scares people because they get really emotional and they say, look, I want the best for my child. And then someone like me comes in and says, okay, that's terrific, but let's talk about what your child, this now legal adult, really can't do without you. And that's what I say to them. If you were not here, who would make sure that your son or daughter would have a proper place to live, would have enough food to eat, would pay bills on time, and that scares them. Now, the system is very complex. It was never designed for anyone other than Social Security employees to understand it. That never changed. The only thing that has changed in all these years is that the public has demanded more information. So now you can go on to ssa.gov and find out anything you want to know. You can read any rule or regulation. That's a terrific thing. Most people can read them and say, oh, okay, I think I understand that. What you don't get is the how does Social Security interpret your answer to any given question? And that's where I come in, because I speak Social Security-ese. If I were to give you a form and say, okay, fill this out, and it's in a language that you don't speak or read or write, you're going to say, excuse me, Dave, but I don't read or write. I have no idea what this says. And then I say, okay, well, too bad. Right. Whether you're going to get a benefit or not depends on how you fill out that form. And it's not that severe, but there are rules and regulations that Social Security has that are not easily understood. That's where parents call me and they say, okay, I tried this on my own. It's not working. And so, you know, to answer your question, that's where I think the fear factor, they're right. intimidated by the rules. And, you know, Social Security has a lot of things to do. Unfortunately, the agency, like a lot of things, mm-hmm. have gotten smaller and smaller employee-wise. Less employees, more people filing. You don't have to answer that one. You know how that's going to play right. out.
So just to go along with the terms that we were talking about, you know, these terms that are specific to Social Security benefits, I came across one when I was researching called substantial gainful activity. Can you explain that a little bit?
Yes. It's a numerical standard that Social Security has placed on wages. And above it, you're not disabled. Below it, you could be.
Okay. I'm going to keep throwing terms at you here, but I feel like there's a lot to understand. I understand that you've been designated a professional disability representative by the Social Security Administration. What exactly does that term mean?
That means that Social Security has looked at who I am, what I do, and the credentials that I have, and they have not only for myself, but all of the individuals that are out there that are professional disability representatives, they passed the law that we are now professional disability representatives.
Okay. So when should parents start to think about filing for Social Security benefits, or when should an individual start to think about that?
Probably right around age 17, 17 and a half,
okay.
to really start looking at income and resources of their child. What's going to happen after the child turns 18? Are they away at school? And that's what I do. I come in and I walk them through a full scenario of the what ifs, and not only what if, but what could then happen with
where to go from there.
Yeah, where to go from there, right.
And how does that process begin? What would you say is like the first step someone should be taking?
First step would be give me a call. The second step would be to. Because there are basically three parts, and I think you said to me that you've already talked about with financial planners, special needs trusts, and those vehicles for saving money. The next step, obviously, is to actually file the applications. Now, Social Security Disability, SSDI, you can file that at any time as long as you have enough quarters of coverage. If you want to file for SSI, normally you wait until after the 18th birthday, and then it's the month after, the first month that you are 18, every second of every minute of every hour of every day throughout the month. That's how they phrase it.
Okay.
So birthday is in May, first month of entitlement is June. That potentially could be paid to you in August.
And you mentioned trusts and that sort of thing. How do you work in conjunction with financial planners and other people associated with a special needs team, or is each component separate?
No. When I started the company, I made the decision that I would work with individuals that have the same feelings towards individuals that I do, which is I want for people to get the best representation they possibly can, and I want for them to talk to other individuals, attorneys, special needs attorneys who write the special needs trust, financial planners who actually can help them plan how are you going to fund this thing called a special needs trust.
Right. It's a team mentality.
It's a team mentality, yes. Okay. And I work with a lot of probably seven or eight attorney firms right now, probably four or five doctors, and several financial planners. That help people figure out where do I put the pennies and when.
For the SSI benefits we discussed, you need a doctor's report. What can a doctor write in a report that will tell Social Security this person is disabled? Is there some phrase, like key phrase?
No, not really. What people should know, though, is your doctor will never be asked, is Dave, disabled. They're not asked that. They're asked, what treatment do you provide? What medications? What tests have you sent the person for? Have you referred them to other doctors? Have you had them admitted to the hospital? Basically, what we get from doctors is an analysis, progress reports, office visitation reports, and then there's a very long part to this, but very quickly, there are things called impairment listings, and that's what the agency looks at. They take the medical evidence, compare it to a medical impairment listing, because you said that you have autism. What doctors do you go to, a psychiatrist? What meds do you take, and what listing would you meet or equal? Okay. And again, that's where I come in to translate Social Security ease language and terminology to regular English so people can understand it.
Another common question I came across was, what do parents do about bank accounts in their child's name? Is that going to work against them somehow?
It all depends on, and I'm not a financial planner, but from what the financial planners say to me is, if the bank accounts are the child's money. Now, the money in there could be money that mom and dad has put aside for you. Okay, well, that technically could be their money, not your money.
Right.
Okay, especially if you didn't know the account existed, you've never had access to it. But more times than not, you know, grandma gave some bonds or $50 at Christmas. But there, that's a very long answer as well about how to remove impediments such as a bank account from Social Security. Resource limits, which is $2,000.
It's really like on an individual basis.
Yes, it's definitely on an individual basis.
Okay. What about if a person, an individual with disabilities or an individual on the autism spectrum is working? How is that going to work into their benefits?
If they are working and they're receiving SSDI, then the SGA we just talked about comes into play. If they are on SSI, it basically is a dollar-for-dollar reduction.
Okay.
But there are a lot of things that can come into play there. There are things called income-related work expenses, subsidies, medications you pay for, so you have to take the meds to go to work. All of these things could reduce the amount of wages that you are actually receiving as far as Social Security is concerned.
Okay. And how long does it take to get approved for these benefits from the time you apply to getting approved and actually getting this money?
Social Security says that 3 to 5 months for them to make an initial claim. There are basically four steps. There's an initial claim, 3 to 5 months. Reconsideration if you're denied the first time, 3 to 5 months. A request for a hearing. Those are running about 10 months right now before you get to go to a judge.
Okay.
And then you have appeals counsel. Some of my clients, we're together for like almost 2 years before we can get a case resolved. But a lot of cases go through 5, 6, 7 months.
Okay. And you mentioned reconsideration and appeals process. So what exactly happens if you are denied benefits when you first apply? What do you do from there?
Again, you go online to the Social Security website. You fill out a request for reconsideration. You then get to look at the medical evidence that they looked at. Mm-hmm. And then you could say, well, wait, they never got the report from Dr. Dave. Without that report from Dr. Dave, there's no way they're going to determine my son to be disabled. So then we contact Dr. Dave and find out why Dr. Dave didn't send in a report. We tell Social Security that this report is essential. They then go get it, and then someone else looks at it, not the first person who denied it, someone else looks at it and makes a decision.
And you're saying all this information is available just online. Anyone can go on to the Social Security website and find it for themselves?
No. You can get a disc from Social Security that shows all of the medical reports, and you can look at them.
Okay.
Representatives get them more than the public does. And then if you do get denied the second time at reconsideration, then you file for a hearing, and that's where we go to a judge. And my client and I sit before the judge, and the judge, I initiate it by doing a pre-hearing submission, which tells Social Security all of the things that I think this person, illnesses, injury, and conditions the person has, what medical listings might be applicable and why I believe that the person is disabled. The judge then interviews the person and then makes a decision.
Okay.
If the judge still says no, then we go to appeals counsel, and that is exactly what it sounds like. It's an entity of Social Security that reviews all of the decisions prior to that, all of the forms that were used, all of the rules and regulations pertaining to disability to see if there was an error made somewhere.
Okay.
Now, my job is to point the errors out to them.
Right, right.
Let's be honest, that's what I do. And so then they would send it back, and sometimes they would approve the claim. They would send it back for another hearing.
I understand.
So that's how it works.
What are some common difficulties you've seen people face as they go along in this process, and how can you avoid them or preempt them?
The number one has to be emotion. Parents fill out the forms. There's activities of daily living. An ADL for short. That document is where you tell the story of what the individual cannot do without training, without monitoring, without advanced training, and without a support system. Okay? Well, if you say that I could put a jacket on, you know, okay, that's the physical side of putting a jacket on. But do you have pain when you put the jacket on? Would you wear the appropriate jacket for the conditions that are out? Do you interact appropriately with the opposite sex? Do you interact just in general with the general public? What about in a work environment? Do you need extra supervision? Do you need a job coach? And again, I mentioned the terms of subsidies and income-related work expenses. How do those play into what you can do and you can't do? All right. You're not allowed to use the stove. You can only use the microwave to heat up things.
There's a lot of facets to consider.
Yep. Have you had a driver's? Do you have a driver's license? Has the state said, no way, nope, not going to have a driver's license? So those are all the things that you have to look at as you go through this process.
Mm-hmm. And how can Medicare play into this?
Medicare is the medical part to SSDI. Just like you hear about Medicare for retired people, maybe you got a grandparent or two that's on Social Security retirement, and they get Medicare. People who are disabled get Medicare 24 months after they are determined to be disabled. It's the easiest way to remember. And that is only on the SSDI side. On SSI, remember, there's only one medical decision for both programs.
Okay.
But on the SSI side, you get the Title 19, which is the state Husky and medical plans. You get the gray medical card.
And how soon into all this process should one consider hiring a representative such as yourself?
When in the process?
Yeah.
I tell people the sooner the better. Because everything that you say to Social Security, everything you put your signature to, is now a document of the Social Security Administration. And the fine print, which they always tell everybody, read the fine print.
Yeah.
No one does. You give carte blanche to Social Security to check into anything that they believe necessary to check into.
Okay.
Bank accounts, you name it.
Yeah.
And so, obviously, you know, you can't lie to Social Security. You just can't make things up. But how you speak to them, again, comes around to this Social Security ease.
Okay.
So that's the number one.
That's the main benefit, just to have someone who speaks the language.
Yeah, yeah, that's certainly, you know, it's very important to have someone who speaks the language.
So we're running a little short on time, but before we go, what's the single most important piece of advice you can give to a parent with a child on the spectrum who's looking into Social Security benefits?
Find someone knowledgeable, for one. Two, be prepared. It's not you. It can be a long process. It can be very frustrating. But at the end of the day, you will get there.
Okay. Thank you for joining us tonight and giving our viewers all this valuable information.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a pleasure.
Thank you all for being with us tonight. I hope you got some useful information. If you're looking for any more information, you can visit PSA's website at www.psassistance.com. You can also visit our website, ASRC's website, at www.ct-asrc.org. I want to thank Dave for being with us tonight and all of you, our production crew as well, who always does a great job of helping us put on this show. And we'll see you all next time. Thank you.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life, you were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see. All your life, you are only waiting for this moment to be free. Blackbird fly, blackbird fly, into the line of a dark black night. Black.